image of God is most clearly seen in the person and work of Jesus Christ, because the writer of Hebrews tells us in chapter 1, verse 3, that Jesus Christ is the radiance of God's glory, and that in him is the exact imprint of God's nature. And I think it's a really important thing to think about, because a lot of times people think there's sort of like the God of the Old Testament, and then Jesus comes along and sort of is a gentler version of God. But Scripture tells us that Jesus is God, God the Father, the God that was revealed to Moses on the mountain. When God said to Moses, he proclaimed his name and said, "I'm the God of steadfast love and faithfulness, the Lord who shows mercy and grace." And that is Jesus Christ. And we, of course, see that most clearly on the cross. And it's interesting also because in Exodus, when God is revealing himself to Moses as this God of steadfast love, it's just after the incident with the golden calf. So God doesn't say, "I'm a God of love because you're lovable. I'm a God of love because I am a God of love. I'm the Lord." And of course we see that Jesus on the cross, the innocent Son of God, paying the penalty for the guilt of humanity. He is the God of steadfast love and faithfulness, clearing the iniquity of the guilty, just as he told Moses. He actually said, "I'm going to visit the iniquity of the guilty on them and on their generations." But instead we see God placing the iniquity of the fathers on his own Son and rescuing us from the fall and the consequences of our sin.
Jesus perfectly expresses everything that God intended humanity to be. He perfectly reflects the character of God. We see that in the way that he is fully obedient to his Heavenly Father. We see that too in the way he interacts with other people. He's always truthful. He's compassionate, he's gracious, he's strong when he needs to be, he's tender when he needs to be. We see lots of combinations of things that we find hard to combine, but we see someone who's got unusual strength and yet doesn't steamroll the vulnerable. Someone who's very, very compassionate and yet able to confront injustice and sin. And we see in Jesus especially the depth of his love. We see him reflecting the love that God the Father has for his creation. Jesus was willing to pour out his life for the sake of others. That is right at the heart of the kind of God we have. And so Jesus shows us what the image of God looks like. And he gives us the opportunity as we follow him, as we are united to him, to become like him and therefore to be better reflecting that image in ourselves. But we get there by looking at Jesus. The more we look at him, actually the more we will become like him.
It's God's intention to have a human king who will rule over his creation as a faithful son and a priest serving in his presence, so that Israel was to do that as royal sons and daughters, a royal priesthood and holy nation. And in their failure, Jesus comes in and he fulfills God's desire for a human king to represent his government on the earth, to rule over all creation as his priest in a covenant relationship. So Jesus establishes the new covenant. And now we as a church are this image of God corporately, both individually as Christians and corporately as a church, that is meant to be a display nation, no longer in a central geographic location, but scattered throughout the world in local churches as embassies of the kingdom of God on this earth, showing the world who God is, what he is like, what it's like to be his people, to live under his rule as we represent his government and live out his kingdom ethic on this earth, calling all people everywhere to repent and to bow down to the true image, Jesus Christ, the King whom he has placed on his throne.
When Satan tempted Eve and Adam in the garden, one of the things he said is, if you take of the fruit of the tree that God has forbidden you to eat from, you will become like God. And of course, when Eve and Adam did that, they didn't become more like God, they became less like God. In other words, Satan said, if you want to be like God, disobey him. In the gospel, God not only deals with the consequences of our sins and brings about forgiveness of sins through his mercy, through Christ alone, He also begins the process of restoring that image in us. In Ephesians 3, 14 to 19, one of my favorite prayers in the Bible, Paul ends that prayer by saying that the work of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in us, is so that we would be filled up to all the fullness of God. That's Ephesians 3:19. Now, I don't know everything that that verse means, but it at least means that God is not only in our salvation forgiving us of sin, He's restoring His image in us.
There's this great lyric in the hymn, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, where it says, Adam's likeness, now efface, stamp thine image in its place. And it's a wonderful phrase that so succinctly captures what is happening in our hearts and our souls as a result of Christ's finished work, that this broken image that comes from sin, that comes from the curse of sin, is slowly and steadily being eroded away. It's been completely cleansed and forgiven by Jesus' work, but in the work of sanctification, that's being slowly drawn out of us and transformed in us. And this new image, this image of Christ, is being, you know, imported in its place. I always, when I think about that lyric, I always think of Ephesians 2:10, where it says that we're His workmanship. There is a work that's going on in us that's transformative, that is making us into something new and something beautiful. The word that's used for workmanship is really a word that implies something beautiful, that implies something new, something glorious as a result of that work. And so I think when we talk about the redemptive work of the image of God, we're moving, it's this beautiful journey, moving away from the corrupted nature of humanity, where we're drawn towards idols, we're drawn towards self-glorification, we're drawn towards even destructive and corrupting work in creation, to being transformed into someone who, like Jesus, is working to redeem things and redeem all things and make all things new. That's something that's happening internal, but it's also something that happens externally as we go out into the world, you know, stamped in the image of Christ, to love our neighbors, to serve our cities, and to do good works for the sake of the new creation.
So how then does the gospel restore the image of God in some way? What is presupposed, of course, is that in some measure the image of God has been disfigured. It's not that we stop being the image of God entirely with sin, but we disfigure it. To begin to see what it looks like, you need to look at a sinless human being, and that brings you to Christ. And in His case, not only does He exemplify the best of what human beings are, the very best, the ideal human being, but also He bears our sin. That's what the gospel is about. He bears our sin in His own body on the tree and restores us in right standing to God, in justification, and transforms us by His powerful Spirit, and ultimately transforms us in glorification with resurrection existence. And that's all part of not only being restored to what we were, but even being transformed beyond that to a level of existence in resurrection life akin to Christ's resurrection existence. And so not only is sin as guilt atoned for, sin as shame is covered over, but all of the detrimental effects in our relationships, in our decay, in our consignment to death, and so on, it's all reversed. It's all reversed. And so we actually only become as fully human in the image of God as we ought to be in the gospel and its effects, both in this life and in the consummation.
The image is somewhat fractured in this life. And what I mean by fractured is that, as we all know, the image consists of a variety of things, both functional characteristics in terms of reason, memory, understanding, will, conscience, as well as an expression of dominion over the creation, our capacity for interrelationship with others. And if we think about all those aspects of human existence now, every one of them is infected by sin. Every one of them is infected by selfishness, ambition that does not have the glory of God as its preeminent aim. And the good news is that in heaven, All of that will be remedied. And the image as God intended it will come to fruition in fullness. So, you know, the New Testament talks repeatedly about us being progressively conformed to the image of Christ, who is the image of God perfectly expressed. And so whatever it is we see in Jesus, we can anticipate we will see in ourselves and in others when we are finally redeemed and glorified and living in the new heavens and the new earth. So that which is fractured will be healed. We won't utilize our reason, our conscience, our wills, or any aspect of what it means to bear God's image for any other purpose other than to enjoy God and to glorify Him forever.
There will be a definite difference between the way we bear the image of God on earth and the way it will be reflected in heaven. There are the mysteries of heaven that we do not know, but there is a very clear pattern for understanding these things, I think, that the scripture gives us, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ Himself. And so Paul says in Philippians 3, our citizenship is in heaven, and we are eagerly awaiting from there the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform these lowly bodies and make them like His own glorious body, with which He is able to subdue all things unto Himself. And so Jesus is this standard, and the reality of heaven is that we will be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. And as John says, we shall be like Him, for we shall see Him as He is. And in that regard, this is the dividing line. We are growing in Christ-likeness as believers in this world. There is among unbelievers this marred, tainted image of God still within us because of sin. And yet, in heaven, we will not just be free from the penalty and the power of sin, but free from the very presence of sin. And Scripture presents that as, in Romans 8:29, as conformity to the image of Jesus Christ, where that promise will be consummated fully in the glories of heaven. And a simple way to describe what the image of God will be reflected in heaven is that we will be just like Christ.
The New Testament really helps us understand what it means that not only were we made in God's image, but the good news that we are being remade in God's image. It doesn't have to be vague for us because of a couple of passages. I'm looking in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 24, where we read this, that we are being renewed in the spirit of our minds. So to be in the image of God is something about the way we think. And to put on the new self, the one created according to God's likeness in righteousness. So there's a moral aspect to this being remade in His image and the purity of the truth. And then when we turn to Colossians in chapter 3, verse 10, similarly, it says we're putting on the new self. You are being renewed in, there's the knowledge word again, according to the image of your Creator. So there's this aspect of being remade in the image of God has to do with right now, in the reality of our lives, that we're beginning to think more like God's thoughts. Instead of being so foolish, more and more we're gaining in the wisdom and knowledge of God. And likewise, we're becoming more righteous, progressively more conformed to Christ's image in terms of righteousness. So there's this progression. We are progressively, even now, being changed into His image. But of course, we're headed into a future of being wholly transformed in His image. Paul writes about that in 1 Corinthians. First, he talks about how we were made, in a sense, in the like Adam. We are descendants of Adam, and so he says in 1 Corinthians 15, and just as we have borne the image of the man of dust. So we were born human, and we got from Adam this sin nature. That meant we're also going to return to the dust. But then there's this incredible hope where it says, we will also bear the image of the man of heaven. That's what's ahead for all who are in Christ. We are going to bear the image of Christ. And once again, there's something tangible to that. Yes, we'll bear his image in this knowledge and righteousness, but there's a physical nature to this. You know, Jesus, when he was raised, he was the first glorified human, but he's only the first. The reality, the hope of the gospel is that he's going to come again and he's going to call us out of our graves and we will be like him.